Please join me in the call to worship. Praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God. For the Lord is gracious, and a song of praise is fitting. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. God gathers the outcasts of Israel. God heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Great is the Lord and abundant in power. The Lord's understanding is beyond measure. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Praise the Lord.
Please be seated. Trusting that the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting, let us join together in the prayer of confession. Let us pray. Loving God, you are always more ready to forgive us than we are to confess our sin. You are always seeking us in love, even when we try to hide from you. So often, we let shame and fear direct our steps instead of hope and trust. We value self-sufficiency over a relationship with you. So often, we have little regard for our neighbors. We put our needs first, forgetting the needs of others. Forgive us, O God, and grant us open hearts to receive the mercy you are so ready to extend to us, that we might live lives that reflect your love for all the world. God's own self-description is compassion, mercy, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. That's how God describes himself in the Old Testament, and that's how God reveals himself in the New. For in Jesus Christ, we come face to face with that God of compassion and mercy and steadfast love. Because of that, we can affirm that God has come into the world not to condemn the world, but to redeem the world, to save the world, that we might have a new beginning. And so trust and believe this good news. In and through the grace of Jesus Christ, we have been forgiven. And friends in Christ, in response to this gift of God's grace, how then shall we live? With gratitude, following after the Lord Jesus Christ, who calls us to love God with heart, soul, mind, and strength, and our neighbors as ourselves. This is the way of Jesus, in whom we find life.
with those who claim the promises of God for their children, and this day we rejoice with Charles and Lauren Whaley as they bring this, their daughter, Margaret Blair Whaley, for baptism this morning. Standing with them this morning for the sacrament is Elder Bruce Hamm, and they are joined in the pews by happy grandparents, family members, and close friends. God, who is overflowing with mercy and love, gives us new birth into a living hope through the sacrament of baptism. By water and the word, God delivers us from sin and death and raises us to new life in Jesus Christ. In baptism, we are united with the body of Christ and joined to Christ's ministry of love, peace, and justice. And so, Charles and Lauren, as you bring this, your daughter, for baptism, I ask you these questions. Do you desire that Margaret be baptized? Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior, trusting in his grace and love? And will you be Christ's faithful disciples, obeying his word and showing his love?
We will.
And relying on God's grace, do you promise to live the Christian life and to teach that faith to your child?
Church promised to tell this new disciple, Margaret Blair Whaley, the good news of the gospel, to help her know all that Christ commands, and by your fellowship to strengthen her family ties with the household of God. If this is your promise, please say, we do.
Okay. We thank you, eternal and gracious God, for nourishing and sustaining all living things by the gift of water. In the beginning, your spirit moved over the watery chaos, calling forth order and life, showing yourself to be a God of life. You led Israel out of slavery through the waters of the sea into the freedom of the promised land, showing yourself to be a God of liberty. In the waters of the Jordan River, Jesus was baptized by John and anointed with your spirit, and we saw both your divinity and your unwavering identity with our humanity. We thank you, O God, for the water of baptism. In it, we are buried with Christ in his death. From it, we are raised to share in his resurrection. Through it, we are reborn by the power of the Holy Spirit. So won't you send your spirit to move over this water, that it might be a fountain of deliverance and rebirth. To you be all praise, honor, and glory, now and forevermore. Amen. What is the name of your child?
Margaret.
Margaret Blair Whaley, child of the covenant and gift to this family and this church, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You have been sealed by Holy Spirit and called as Christ's own forever. Amen. Oh my goodness. Y'all, it is my distinct pleasure to introduce to you Margaret Blair Whaley. She is the newest member of our family of faith here at First Presbyterian Church and in Christ's body. It's a wonderful day for us as we bring her into the life of our church. We have just witnessed a momentous occasion in her life where we have seen the Holy Spirit claim her in the name of Christ so that she might know that she is loved, that Christ's grace is hers. This is a social child, y'all. And that she is loved and held by the grace of God. And you all have made promises to her this day. Bruce has asked you, and you've already said, we do. And that is that you get to know her, that you nurture her, that you teach her, that you encourage her when she's excited, that you comfort her when she is sad, that she might too one day profess her own faith in Jesus Christ and become a full member of the church. See what love the Father has for us, that we should be called children of God. And so indeed we are. And so are you, Margaret. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, giver of all life, we pray for Charles and Lauren. Give them wisdom and patience to guide their child, Margaret, in the way of Jesus Christ and the faith of the church. And let your peace and joy dwell in their home, that their family life may be instructed by faith and sustained by prayer, and above all, governed by love. Strengthen them in their own baptism too, that they may rejoice as children of God and serve you faithfully together. And help those of us who have witnessed this baptism today to support them in their love for Margaret by loving her and by teaching her and by knowing her by name, that one day she too might profess her faith in you. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And now let us sing together.
Good morning. My name's Alice Lutz, and I'm here to tell you a little bit about Triangle Family Services. And I thought I'd start with a story about a baby. Right before Christmas this last year, it was after hours, and I was down in the lobby, and we had a staff person that had a father with the chunkiest, roundest little butterball of a baby 6 months old that he was jostling on his lap, and you could tell he was struggling and having trouble filling out paperwork. So I went up and I said, "Can I hold the baby?" That was my bonus for the day. So I got to entertain the baby, and then the father filled out the paperwork and left it with Karen. I went back downstairs afterwards and said, "Karen, I would like to know kind of the story." She said the mom had suffered severe postpartum depression and had been hospitalized and not seen her baby, now 6 months old, since the baby was 4 months old. They were trying to get the paperwork done so she could have a supervised visit with her child in a safe environment at Triangle Family Services, and that was successful. And so the mom was able to fulfill a Christmas wish and see her baby, hold her baby for Christmas. One day at Triangle Family Services, I saw a man in the parking lot literally fall to his knees, thanking God that we had saved him from foreclosure. He had been caring for his wife, who had passed away with cancer, and he had lost his job. He had lost his wife, lost his job, was losing his home. And through foreclosure prevention, we were able to help that man keep his home and keep his dignity and put his life back together. Families come to us in crisis. Oftentimes they have no place else to turn. I was running in between meetings, and out in front of our building was a mom under the awning letting her car cool down with her son. And I asked if they were okay, and she said, "Yes, I'm okay. I was here seeing Allison, who specializes in working with children who have been sexually abused." And she said, "This was my son's first visit. Can I tell you what he just said to me?" And I'm like, "Yes, please do." And she said, "He wants to know if he can come back tomorrow." At Triangle Family Services, we're a 77-year-old human service agency that is a nonprofit that partners with you here and has partnered with you for many years. And we thank you. We do this work through three core areas: family safety, like the chunky baby I shared with you through our supervised visitation and our batter intervention program; financial stability, like the man who fell to his knees, we help with housing and consumer credit counseling; and mental health, like the child who had a safe visit. And so one of the things I'd like to leave with you today is the complexity of families in crisis. Oftentimes, you don't know how to help, or where to send them. Carol Ann has brochures. I'd encourage you to grab one of these and have them reach out. Go to our website and help. Get your neighbors, your coworkers connected. And we appreciate and respect our partnership. And thank you for helping in our community.
Let me share some of the prayer concerns going on within our life of our church family. We're grateful to finally see some, Donna Hardees finally seems to be on the road to some recovery and is back at Universal Healthcare. She's had quite a journey. Arlene Hines is home from the hospital after back surgery under Fred's good care, and we are grateful for that. Emmeline Ketching let us know this week that her son Tommy was having surgery. He's got a couple of blockages in his legs, and he greatly appreciates the prayers of this church family, as does Emmeline. Ann Wilson is home working hard with therapists following her surgery, and her family appreciates the support and concern that they're receiving. Kind of the extended church family, Julia McCracken's mother is in the hospital in Virginia, serious but stable, we hope, right now following a heart attack. Two of our young members, Jennings Smith and Mary Susan Smith, their mother died just at the end of this week, shortly after receiving a cancer diagnosis. And so we'll want to remember Jennings and Mary Susan in our prayers. I have no idea if this is even appropriate or not, but a lot of people in our part of the world will be grieving. I just learned between services that the iconic coach at UNC, Dean Smith, passed away last night. And some of us grew up watching him, and so this is quite a change in the world. And so we'll remember those who are grieving that. We always have a lot of concerns. The joys here, during the announcements, if another person had been making the announcements, they might have invited you to a baby shower tonight, but Anna felt awkward inviting people to her baby shower. I don't feel awkward about it at all. And so I'm going to use part of this joy and concern time to say that there's a baby shower taking place, and it's not just for Anna, it says on the thing for CJ too. What that means is it opens it up to men and women. So men, if you've been waiting your whole life to see what goes on baby shower, this might be your shot. But that's at 3:00 this afternoon. It's going to take place here in the Lisa Ham Gathering Space. I don't know what to. I've never been to one either, so I don't know what to tell you to expect. But a lot of folks have been involved in getting ready for it. It'll be a wonderful time for us to celebrate as a church family this particular joy that's coming into the life of our church. And so, with that, let us now join together in a time of prayer. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, in whom there is life and life abundant, we bow before you this day in prayer and praise, for we are grateful for your steadfast love and faithfulness. We are grateful for the daily expression of your providential care. We come before your throne of grace this day, knowing that we have been blessed beyond measure, seeking ways to offer ourselves to you. We know, O God, that every day is filled with possibility to serve, to love, to give. We give thanks for every day, but especially we thank you for this day, O God, a day set aside to worship and adore you, a day set aside to spend holy time with you and with your people. When we come together as your people, O God, our hearts are broken by the concerns of the world. We and those we love bear burdens for which we are not equipped. We carry in our hearts cares that would cripple us if we carried them alone, and so we are glad that we are not alone. Glad that we can draw strength from your strength as we learn to depend upon the power of your Spirit. And so we pray, O God, that you will come to us to strengthen us, come into our hearts to fill the emptiness, come into our souls to bring renewal. We pray for your healing power to be at work wherever there is brokenness and pain, for your soothing spirit to be present wherever there is grief, for your compassion and care to minister to those who are downcast or afraid. Lord God, we often pretend that we're strong, but we know we're weak. We pretend that we're courageous, but we know we are afraid. We even pretend to be in control, but in our hearts we know better. And so we turn to you, O God, trusting in your power and your promise, grateful that we belong to you. Lord God, in a world of violence and chaos and bitterness and cruelty, we pray for glimpses of your hand at work. We pray for glimpses of your promised kingdom. Whenever we see them, it keeps us from losing heart and losing hope. And so we pray that you'll continue to reveal yourself to us, that we might know of your abiding presence with us in the world. And eternal God, we pray that you will enable us to live not for self, but for you, not for self, but for neighbor. Continue to call us to a holy life, that Christ might be seen in us. Hear these in all of our prayers, for we make them in his perfect name as we pray together the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I'd like to invite the children to come join me now for a moment together. Good morning. Two more coming. All right. It's nice to see you this morning. I'm going to test your memory a little bit. I'm going to see if you can remember something that happened a little while earlier in the service. So I'll sort of walk you through it. I just finished praying, and maybe you heard that. And right before I prayed, a woman talked to us about how we are helping some people in the world who have real needs. Right before that was a really exciting thing. We got to see a baby being baptized. Do y'all remember that? You remember all the way back to that? Okay. Do you remember what happened right before that? What happened right before that, I know this sounds a long time ago, but that pretty young woman right over here stood up and sang a song. Do you remember that? She stood right up here and sang a song. Her name is Kimberly. And she sang a song that a lot of us know, and a lot of it's one of our favorite songs, and the title of it is, Here I Am, Lord. And she just didn't make that up. Here I am is a phrase that gets used in the Bible a lot. Because every now and then, somebody in the Bible has this feeling that God needs something done, and even though the person doesn't even know what they might be getting themselves into, they say, Here I am, Lord. Here I am. Sometimes they're afraid of what God wants them to do. Sometimes they're pretty sure they don't even know how to do it. But because it's something that God needs done, what do they say? Here I am. I'll try. Use me if you want to. Use me, but help me. And so it's a wonderful psalm because it reminds us that that didn't happen just way back in Bible times. That's still happening today. We might have a feeling that maybe that God wants to do something through us. God needs somebody maybe in our class at school or on the playground or at home. God needs somebody to do something that's kind or generous or loving or good or humble. And we could always sit around and say, well, I hope God gets somebody else to do it. And that's what a lot of us do. Or we could say, here I am. I'll try my best, God, but if you'll help me. And that's really what that song was about. That's why it's a favorite song of so many people. And it's why I'm glad Kimberly got to sing it for us today. It reminds us that that's really kind of a starting point for us being disciples of Jesus, is being willing to say, here I am. And it's not here I am because I'm the strongest and best and smartest one around. It's here I am. If you think I can do it, God, I guess I can. I'll trust you to help me do it. So I don't know if you've ever had that feeling that I really ought to do something because I really think this is what God wants me to do. And maybe you didn't do it because you were afraid. But this song reminds us that even when we're afraid, even when we're not even sure how to do what God's asking us to do, we can say, here I am, and God will find a way to use us, even when we might be afraid or nervous or not even exactly sure how to do what we're being asked to do. So it's a very important conversation that goes on in the Bible. Sometimes the Bible has God saying, who's going to do this for me? And the person says, here I am. And that's how a lot of very, very important stuff gets done in the Bible. And I think it's how a lot of very important stuff still gets done, by people who are willing to say, here I am, Lord. I have to remember that sometimes, so I shared it with you, so maybe you'll remember it. Okay? Let's pray about this. Let's bow our heads. Dear God, send us, lead us, help us be your people. Help us remember to say, here I am, Lord. Amen. Thanks for coming to see me today. Some of you might be heading off to Children's Church, or you might want to go back and sit with your pew in the pew. So it'd be good to visit with you.
Thank you. Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may hear your joy with what you say to us today. Amen. This scripture lesson comes from Psalm 40, verses 1 through 11 and 17. Listen to the word of the Lord. I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up from the desolate pit, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put trust in the Lord. Happy are those who make the Lord their trust, who do not turn to the proud, to those who go astray after false gods. You have multiplied, O Lord my God, your wondrous deeds and your thoughts towards us. Were I to proclaim and tell of them, they would be more than can be counted. Sacrifice and offering you do not desire, but you have given me an open ear. Burnt offering and sin offering you have not required. Then I said, here I am. In the scroll of the book, it is written of me. I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is within my heart. I have told the glad news of deliverance in the great congregation. See, I have not restrained my lips. As you know, O Lord, I have not hidden your saving help within my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your salvation. I have not concealed your steadfast love and your faithfulness from the great congregation. Do not, O Lord, withhold your mercy from me. Let your steadfast love and your faithfulness keep me safe forever. As for me, I am poor and needy, but the Lord takes thought for me. You are my help and my deliverer. Do not delay, O my God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our New Testament lesson this morning follows on the heels of the story that Ed shared with us last week about Jesus healing a man with an unclean spirit in the synagogue, thus revealing God to be a God who desires to deliver us from the things that hold us captive. Our passage today is actually three short but important scenes in the early days of Jesus's ministry in Galilee, though we will focus our attention this morning mostly on the first two or three verses. Jesus and his first four disciples have left the synagogue to go home to Simon's house. Let us listen now for the word of the Lord as it comes to us in Mark chapter 1, verses 29 through 39. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed, and Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring town so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. Here ends our reading. This too is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And again, let us pray. Come and be present with us, O God, as we seek you this morning. And meet us where we may be found to surprise us with a word from you this morning. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. If you've ever been a student of the Gospels,
ever dug deeply into the four books of the New Testament that recount the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, then you've noticed along the way that each gospel kind of has its own style, its own literary trademarks and theological emphases. This, of course, has along the way caused some to become skeptical about how reliable the gospels are in being able to report accurately the events of Jesus's life. But for me and for others, the distinct storytelling style of the four gospel writers only adds color and depth to the overall picture of Jesus that they provide for us. The same way four people with four very different personalities might recount the same story in their own unique voices. Mark, for instance, is a gospel of action. It's a gospel of verb after verb after verb with little time for adjectives along the way. The story of Jesus seems to move at quite a clip in Mark because of this storytelling style. And so reading Mark reminds me of listening to my four-year-old nephew Parker as he breathlessly recounts the highlights of his day at preschool. First, we sat in a circle, then we sang our morning song, then Miss Stephanie gave me a hug, then we went on the playground and I played Monster with my friends. Then I ate grapes for lunch, but William had goldfish. And then we played trucks. And then, and then, and then. It is a fast-paced gospel. Another thing to notice about Mark's style is that he is a man of few words. His prose is straightforward and efficient and spare. And not a single word is wasted, but every single one is intended to make clear, to fill out the picture of Jesus's life without too many distracting frills or flourishes. Think Hemingway, not Steinbeck. The first chapter alone is chock full of these huge, important gospel milestone stories that are recounted in just a few short verses. Jesus's own baptism takes up a mere 3 verses. And is followed directly by his temptation in the wilderness, a drama of truly cosmic proportions, which is confined to just 2 verses. And though her story is much less known, Simon's mother-in-law gets 2 verses of chapter 1 as well. Just 2 verses in a gospel that is fast heading towards Jesus' ministry in Galilee, where he will soon be surrounded by crowds of needy people looking for their restoration. But given what we know about the value of 2 verses in Mark, and the fact that momentous things can happen in just 2 verses, we can be confident that Mark is signaling us here that something vital about Jesus can be seen here. Something no less important than what is revealed about him at his baptism, when he comes up out of the waters and God says, "You are my son, the beloved, with you I am well pleased." By giving her 2 whole verses, Mark is asking us to slow down and to take note of a tender, private scene between Jesus and this woman while the whole human family pushes in from either side of the narrative, waiting for Jesus to carry on with his very public teaching and healing ministry. And what these 2 humble, easy-to-miss verses tell us is that Simon's mother-in-law was sick with a fever. And there's no telling how long she'd been lying there up until that point, memorizing perhaps the details of the curtain folds and the wallpaper, passing the time in her dimly lit room by threading the edges of her blanket between her fingers back and forth, back and forth. The fever had not just taken her strength. It had shrunk her world down to these 4 walls from a world that had been purposeful and busy and full of people. It was a physical condition, yes, but the fever was also a new social arrangement for her, which kept this woman away from the life that was hers. It had plucked her from every role that filled out her identity, and on top of it all, since so many people in those days assumed a link between illness and the demonic, they had all sort of kept their distance from her just in case they too might be infected by her situation. And that was the real tragedy of it all. The way that fear and lack of understanding about her condition eroded the community around her, which is the effect that fear and lack of understanding always have on communities. The physical condition, just a fever, was very likely treatable without miracle, but the unraveling of relationships, the isolation and its concomitant loss of identity, that was something else altogether. So you can imagine what it must have felt like for her when Simon and the others brought Jesus to her at the end of a very long day. What it must have been like when he got there and when he stooped down to where she was, and in an act that was equal parts simple and radical in that culture, took her by the hand and lifted her up and changed her life forever. And at once, Mark tells us, she got up and began to serve them. As CJ and I have been preparing for the arrival of our baby girl this April, we've spent some time perusing the classes that the hospital offers for new parents, clueless new parents. And recently, when I signed us up for the standard introductory class, I noticed that one of the classes on offer is infant massage. And I was reminded of an experience I had while I was on a mission trip in Russia 7 or 8 years ago. I was there with a group of women from my church in Charlotte, one of whom was a nurse who had been on the trip once before. And so she already knew some of the people in the congregation that we were visiting. And she had heard just before we were set to go that one of the young couples in the congregation had just had their first baby. And so she was particularly eager to see them and, in her words, get her hands on that baby. And so on the day we were going out to visit people in their homes to bring medical supplies and toiletries, we made a special stop by this couple's small one-room apartment. And when we walked in, we found the baby lying on a bare mattress while her mother and grandmother watched over her from their chairs across the room. We six crammed in together like sardines there, and we had been visiting for a while when my friend, the nurse, asked if she could hold the baby. And the mother said, "Oh no, we try not ever to hold her because we don't want her to get used to it. She will not have this in her life." As we talked more about it, we learned that day that they wanted her to grow, to be strong and independent and confident in a culture and an economic reality that demands these things for daily survival, and that also looks down on need for physical affection as a sign of weakness. It was a heartbreaking moment on an otherwise joyful day as we wondered what this little girl's life might be like in the days and years ahead. But just before we got up to leave, my friend, the nurse, asked the young mother if she had any medical questions pertaining to her child that she might help her with. And quite unexpectedly, she said that she did. She had heard about something called therapeutic massage, and could my friend tell her about it? And with that, my friend lit up and began telling her about all of the benefits of infant massage. How it helps to stimulate nerve growth and build muscle tone, how it promotes healthy sleep and stimulates circulation, how it can help infants to know that they are safe and loved in order that they may begin to grow up to be strong and independent and confident. "May I show you how?" my friend asked. And the baby's mother said she could, and so all of us who were there watched on as my friend picked up the child and began to rub her arms and her legs, her back and her tummy. And we witnessed the child, very precious before this experience, light up with the touch and begin to smile and interact and squeal at her mother, who in turn lit up with the relief that it was okay for her to touch her baby. And that actually she needed to be touched to be brought more fully alive. Sometimes the simplest gestures have the most profound capacity to bring about new life. We have actually already proclaimed that truth today as a community as we witnessed the baptism of Margaret Blair Whaley. What happened was quite simple, but also quite profound. A handful of water was smeared upon an infant's forehead, and she was claimed as God's own forever. And we as a community claimed the promises of God for her alongside her parents, that though there may be times in her life when she is brought low, in Christ she is lifted up. That though the world will ask her to be many things, that the most important thing about her is that she is a child of God, beloved, claimed, cleansed, and free. As water dribbled over her small brow, the Holy Spirit made this so. And we prayed on the occasion of this very simple gesture that she too might one day profess her faith and become a servant of God. Baptism is a gesture that is at once incredibly simple and radically life-affirming. And this, I think, is how God chooses to work in the world. Jesus holds the hands of someone that others were trying their best to avoid, and she is raised to new life and new purpose. A word of encouragement frees someone from the bounds of perfectionism. A hand extended gives courage to the faint of heart to do a difficult thing. A meal delivered brings warmth beyond the meeting of physical hunger. A difficult anniversary remembered and honored by someone else eases the burden, however slightly. A text message sent to a friend on an important day reminds that friend that they are known and loved. A thumbs up from a parent in an audience gives a child the courage to sing. And water is poured on a baby's head, and she is claimed as God's own forever. And actually, there's more to it than even that. In our story, Jesus reaches out to Simon's mother-in-law, and at once, Mark tells us, she got up and began to serve them. In the Greek, Mark's mother-in-law becomes, in verse 31, not just a restored woman, but the first diakonos, the first deacon, the first servant of God's kingdom, ahead of even Christ's freshly called male disciples. And being a servant in God's kingdom is what it is to be truly alive. They are just two verses, but in them, Mark shows us the pattern of how God chooses to work in this world, and we dare not overlook it. And that pattern is this. God comes to those the world has actively forgotten, and he stoops down. And ruled by love instead of fear, he takes the risk to reach out to his beloved, and he lifts his beloved up to be the first in the kingdom of God, servant leaders whose lives mirror the promise of the resurrection, that once we were laid low, but in Christ, God has raised us up. Once we were alone, but now we are brought into God's family. Once we were despairing, but now we have been made a people of hope. Once we had nothing to do, but now we've been extended a hand and are being led into a calling beyond our wildest dreams. Do you see what can happen in just two easy-to-miss verses? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
Some of our confessional documents date back to the early days of the Christian church. The one we're using today dates all the way back to 1983. The brief statement of faith was crafted in honor of the reunion of the Southern and Northern Presbyterian church families, and a sense that we need to say something about what we believe. It doesn't try to say everything, but it's designed to be used in worship. It's short, and we're using a portion of it today. So let us draw from these fairly recent words to say what we believe. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed and blessing the children, healing the sick and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised this Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, delivering us from death to life eternal. Please be seated. And now, in an act of glad generosity, let us present God's tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Lord God of grace, in response to how you have come among us with love and grace, we offer ourselves to you. We dedicate ourselves and these gifts to you. We give you thanks for your generosity to us, and we seek to live in generous praise now and forever through Christ our Lord. Amen.
With hope and enjoy and be led back in peace. Go in the knowledge that in the goodness of God you were born. In the providence of God you are kept all the days of your life. And in the love of God fully revealed in Jesus Christ, you and I, we are redeemed. Thanks be to God. Amen.